Good morning, good morning. Well, I'm progressing through the week. I'm getting a little bit better. I'm not there yet, unfortunately. I'm hoping for Sunday that I might be able to get back, but I'm not seriously not thinking I'm going to make it for Sunday. So we'll see. So keep me in your prayers, please. Now let's start with a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time. Good look at your word, and that we can help you to help us, Lord, to see to get to know you better and better, because you are the rock, Lord. You are our rock, and I rely on you and look forward to you helping us through all of our trials and tribulations, good times and bad times. And I thank you for the opportunity to get stronger through this virus, and that it'll make me stronger to withstand the winter months against other viruses that are more dangerous. We give you the praise and thanks. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. So I labeled this one because we got to see this scene here in a minute. On Christ the rock I stand, a solid rock I stand. It's a hymn I really always loved. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is shifting sand. All other ground is shifting sand. Excuse my voice, not quite a singing voice today, but I thought that was a great example of what this is about today. This last part of Luke 6, 37 through 49. Try to get through the rest of it today. So let's get some verses over here. We got a picture for this one. It's towards the end of this section, so I put this one back up again. And you see on the left here, you got the house is built on solid rock, on a good foundation. That's what that this is all about. And of course, the one that was built on sand, when the waters came, in other words, tribulation, worldly pressure, that got washed away. And that's kind of the theme of today's lesson. Let's just get into the verses. A little bit longer today, I think, maybe than last couple of days. My voice is a little bit better. We'll see how it does. Judge not, and ye shall not be judged. Condemn not, and ye shall not be condemned. Forgive, and ye shall be forgiven. This verse has been overly used for centuries, I'm sure. Every time I point out something that makes somebody feel guilty in the Bible, they got to throw this verse at me. You want to claim that I'm judging them. Well, if I'm using Jesus' words out of the Bible, I don't think I'm judging somebody. But I think it's important, too, that when we're pointing out the things that Jesus says, we do it with kindness and with a loving spirit. But that don't sugarcoat what Jesus says because of somebody might have hurt feelings. I'm sure that plenty, as we know, hated Jesus. They tried to stone him. They tried to throw him off cliffs. He was not well loved either. So everybody tries to say that God is love. Yes, he is. But just like any parent knows, a parent sometimes has to discipline their children because they don't do what you tell them. And that's what today's lesson is really about. So as I like to say when people say that, I says, well, I'm not judging you, but God is going to. And I'd like to study and learn about God and find out what he likes and dislikes. I like the analogy of thinking about, you're working at a company and the owner leaves, and maybe he's an older gentleman or a lady, and passes on, and they're going to get a new CEO for the company. And so you're wondering if he or she, what she's like, what she's going to be like, what her dislikes or likes are. And so that's the same way I treat the Bible, is that we're going to spend eternity with Jesus Christ. That's a long time, folks. So I think I'd like to know a little bit about him. And the only place I'm going to find out right now is through the Bible and prayer and a relationship with him. That's how you get to know somebody. And so if your boss doesn't like it when you're, some bosses used to be tougher about being on time. I remember bosses saying that, to me, on time is when you're 10 minutes early. When you're right on the hour mark, that's late. And so, every boss has their little quirks. Maybe there's ones that don't, are very temperamental when it comes to doing certain things on business hours. Some are, some aren't. So you learn all those little things. It's no different with God. And God's ways are perfect. So everything he's suggesting for us to do is perfect. But of course, the world has its ways too. And some of those ways seem like a lot of fun at first. But trust me that in the long run, God's ways are better and much more enjoyable in the long run. So when people throw that verse on me too, I like to say, I'm a sinner too, just like you. We're all sinners. I have done my fair share of sinning and I've repented for it. And that's the point, is I'm trying to, I once, when I was learning about the Bible, this usually happens with young Christians, because they'll hear something like, well, God is love. They just hear a statement like that and think that he doesn't punish anybody. That's the farthest thing from the truth. The beauty of God is that he's completely righteous in his judgment, and he knows exactly what's in our hearts. And so even if it looks like we break a rule, in our hearts, maybe we didn't. I thought of a cute little story I thought I'd share. This came out of my head. It wasn't something I experienced necessarily. Let's say you have a little girl named Sally. And fictitious person. I don't even know a Sally, young girl. And she's just one of those kinds of people that when you get her all dressed up for church, somehow, some way, she seems to get dirty, and she ruins her dress. And that, and even deep down inside, maybe it bothers her, maybe it doesn't. But on the outside, all you can do is say, is it you need to instruct her that, honey, you're in your best clothes. I want you to stay clean until we head for church. And so you get her all dressed up, and she promises she ain't gonna get dirty. She promises, and she's not gonna do anything wrong. And she said, Mom, can I go sit on the porch and wait for us to leave? And she said, Sure, do not get in any mud puddles or anything. Yes, Mom, I won't. So little Sally goes outside, and she's standing there in the front, and kind of watching the cars go by, and looking at the birds and the trees, and nothing really, nothing. It's been raining, so there's some puddles in the streets, and of course the temptation is there to go out and jump in one of those puddles, but she knows Mom is going to get really upset about it, and so she's standing there very quietly, trying not to get her dress dirty. And all of a sudden, this big truck comes by and hits this puddle and spreads dirty water all over her. And all of a sudden, the girl is just sopping wet with dirty water. And she goes running in the house and she's trying to explain. And our first reaction sometime is, Sally, didn't I tell you not to go play in the puddles? Not really knowing exactly what happened. And sometimes we don't even let them react. Let's take it from God's point of view. Let's say that you, as a mother, went to go check on her, and you walked by a window, and you kind of looked out, and you saw her standing there very quietly, waiting, just kind of looking around and waiting for them to come out to the car, and you see this thing happen with a truck at the puddle, and got her all dirty by no fault of her own. And that's God, okay? God knows what our true feelings were. So Sally was trying really hard not to stay clean, but now she didn't. She failed. And so that's kind of like how I like to think about God, is that he knows us on the inside. So even if we fail on the outside on occasions, he knows the inside. I'm going to get teared up. Because honestly, I've been there where I think I'm doing good, and then I fail again. So let's get back in the lesson before I really choke up. So let's move on. So judge not, and you shall not be judged. Some companion verses for this over in Luke 18:9 through 14. And I like this story from this standpoint about basically what Jesus is saying here, and I think this illustrates it really well. And he spoke this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up into the temple to pray, and one a Pharisee and the other a publican. And the Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as this other men are, extortionists, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. I fast twice in a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. You see the pride there, that he thinks he's so righteous and he's perfect. Verse 13. And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes into heaven, but smote upon his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. This is Jesus speaking, by the way. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. I think that's what Jesus is trying to say here, is that you're trying to help out a brother, and that's what he's saying, is don't judge based on appearances. That it's okay to point things out, but realize that God is the judge, and he's going to be the final determining factor. We're not. We're only trying to help our brothers, because we're just as guilty as that person is. Also in John 8, 1 through 11, another perfect example of the kind of forgiveness that only God can really give. And that, again, appearances. I think that if most people saw this particular story and Jesus wasn't around, they'd probably continue to stone her because that's what the law said. But that Jesus knew her heart. And so let's read this story. It's in John 8, 1 through 11. And Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives. And early in the morning he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman caught, taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, I want to point out a thing, they brought her, but not the men. If they caught them in the act of adultery, there had to be a man there too, and they didn't bring him. So that's an important point. And they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Confirmed right there. Because the actual punishment was for both of them. But I've been willing to bet that the man was somebody of influence or somebody that was able to talk his way out of it, but not the woman. Continuing, John 8, 5. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned, but what sayest thou? And this they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground, as though he heard them not. I love this, a famous writing on the ground. Everybody wants to know what he was writing. Lots of different speculations. I think my favorite one is he was writing down the Ten Commandments, or he was writing down the sins that those men around him had committed. But maybe Jesus will tell us someday. 8:7. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, being at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. And when Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are those that thine accused? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. I think that's the important aspect there. Remember, is that Jesus basically forgave her. He knew her heart, and she was feeling really bad, and that she needed forgiveness. She didn't need to be stoned. So that's a great story, I think, when it comes to our relationship. We're all sinners. Nobody's more of a sinner than another. And by the way, the whole reason for that whole stoning back in that time frame was based more about hereditary reasons is that they needed to keep the bloodlines pure on the 12 tribes of Israel. So if you didn't have children only with your own husband, then there was a tendency to get off the bloodline. That's a some belief. I'm not saying adultery is it's still a sin. It's written right in the Ten Commandments. But we should realize too that we are all sinners and we've all committed some sins. I like what Paul says, I'm the chief among sinners. And that's the way we got to think about ourselves. That we're no better than nobody else. Okay, back to Luke 6:38. Give it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down and shaken together and running over, shall man give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you met withal, it shall be measured to you again. So, in other words, have the same attitude towards your fellow man as you would want put on yourself. That's just another way of saying, do unto others as you expect others to do unto you. Proverbs 28:27. He that giveth unto the poor shall not lack, but he that hideth his eyes shall have many a curse. So be willing to be up front with the Lord. Realize that who you are. You're not hiding anything from him. 2 Corinthians 9, 6 and 7. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man accordingly as he purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or in necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Talking again back on that verse 38, which we talked about, I guess refresh our memory. Give and it shall be given unto you. That's why I put that in there. Okay, verse 39. And he spake a parable unto them, can the blind lead the blind, shall they not both fall into the ditch? The disciple is not above his master, but everyone that is perfect shall be as his master. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but perceivest not the beam that is in our own eye? Even how castest thou say to thy brother, brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thine eye, when thou myself beholdest not the beam that is in thy own eye? Thou hypocrite, cast out first the beam out of their own eye, and then shalt thou be able to see clearly to pull out the mote that is in their brother's eye. In other words, don't make their sins any worse than yours. In other words, realize that you're a sinner too. So come humbly when you're advising a brother, and that you reach him in a loving way as a fellow sinner, not as some high and mighty person that is above reproach. Some verses on this, Paul writes over in Galatians 6, 3 through 7. For if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself. But let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone, and not in another. For every man shall bear his own burden. Let him that is taught in the word communicate unto them that teacheth in all good things. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whosoever a man soweth, then shall he also reap. So again, it's just basically talking about that help a brother out. There are things that particularly newer Christians don't know about the Lord, and I see nothing wrong with helping a brother learn about the Lord. And that's how I like to try to take it, but I'll tell you, it never fails. And that's why I'm very careful to quote scripture. Let the word say it for himself. Nobody can come back on me and say that I didn't at least show you in scripture where it says something. So that I'm not just saying it off the top of my head. Because I've had people attack just based on, well, you're judging me. I said, no, I'm not. I don't even know you. You know, this might be somebody online or something who's making a comment about something. And for the others, mainly for the others present that may be new, I like to try to throw in a verse on the subject and what Jesus has to say, or somebody else in the Bible, that is good solid doctrine. And so that a lot of times that brings the attention back on me, though. But so I try to be very, very careful that I'm not getting into a debate. And I have fallen into a few. So I'm trying not to allow myself to get into a debate. If it gets to the point where the person is not going to listen anyway, then I'm not accomplishing anything. Okay, back to Luke 6:43. For a good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit, neither doth a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. For every tree is known by his own fruit. For of thorns men do not gather figs, nor of bramble bush gather a grapes. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of his heart his mouth speaketh. I think that's something that, and to me, this is talking about testimony. Let's say that, and I'm guilty of this in my past, that you're the person that is in church on Sunday, and you seem really upright and not doing anything wrong. But on Saturday night, you're out there in the bars drinking it up and boozing it and carrying on. And if a brother who saw you in church also saw you in the bar, that's not a very good testimony. And so you're not helping that brother. You're providing a stumbling block. So be careful about our testimony. It can be a tough thing. And so I think it's probably one of those situations that you have to take it to the Lord. It's not something that we're supposed to necessarily, confront the brother on. But just be available, maybe, on the side in quietness, might say if that scenario, I kind of wish at times that somebody would have been my back and would have kind of taken me aside and says, Dana, that's not a good thing. You're really, when you get into that alcohol stuff, you turn into a new person and you need to take it to the Lord, that you need to try to, see if you can do better in those areas, I think. But take it to the Lord. I'm not passing judgment, but I think that it gives a mixed message to our newer brethren. And I kind of wish at times that people would have. Now, I probably would have been argumentative, and I definitely wouldn't do it while the person was drinking. But I probably would have been argumentative at the time. Oh, I don't drink too much, or the alcohol's in the Bible. I had all kinds of excuses. And so, and sometimes all you can really do is point something, be a helpful hand, say, well, I'm there if you need me. Call me if you're out, you have a little bit too much to drink, I'll give you a ride home. Try to be a help. So, almost got teary-eyed over that one too. Okay, some examples of this section about providing good fruit. From Matthew 12, 34 and 35. Oh, generation of vipers, this is Jesus talking to the Pharisees. How can you being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart thy mouth speaketh. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasures bringeth forth evil things. There's no in between point. You're either bringing forth good fruit or you're not. Some Proverbs that kind of speak to this too. Proverbs 15:2. The tongue of the wise use knowledge all right, but the mouth of the fools poureth out foolishness. Well, speaking of drinking, that is definitely some of the things that have come out of my mouth have just been. I'm so ashamed when I realize what I said. I spent a lot of time apologizing to friends. Verse 28. The heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. Up to Proverbs 16:23, the heart of the wise teacheth his mouth, and addeth learning to his lips. Amen. 18:21, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Yeah, the tongue can cause more damage than the worst military piece of equipment. Used to be a term in the military called "loose lips sink ships." That was basically a way of saying that be careful what you talk about because you can give away information about your position and your military formation, even in idleness, like if you're in the local supermarket or things of that nature. Okay, Luke 6:46. And why call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? That is the perfect verse. Why is it that we want to always turn to the Lord for help, but we don't want to listen to what he says? We try to sugarcoat it and turn it into something that's not. He's got plenty to say, but you got to read it all. You can't just read the parts that say love. You also got to read the parts that say judgment and find out what upsets the Lord. Some other examples over in Revelation 1:8. I just bring this one up mainly that God is. Why did I bring this one up? Trying to remember why I put it there. Think basically the reason I put it in there is to realize that Jesus has been around forever. Oh, I know what I was going to say. You'll sometimes get people too to try to say that the Old Testament doesn't apply, or that this is a new age. That things are different now than they were in Jesus' time. And I just want to point this out that Jesus never said the things which would be in this verse. He basically says that nothing is going to change from day one to the end. I am the Alpha and Omega. That's the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come. The Almighty. He has always been, always will be, and always will be to come. His words never change. He has not changed from day one in Genesis 1:1 until Revelation 22. I forget which verse it is. So that people try to say, well, it's a new age, and God is different now. No, he's not. He gave us the whole Bible to study. That's well, Genesis all the way through. Okay, back to Luke 6:47. Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built a house and dig deep and laid the foundation on a rock. And that's what we got over here. Nice house built on a rock there. I see the river is going around it, not over the top of it. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently upon the house and could not shake it, for its foundation founded upon a rock. And that's our lives with Jesus, is that we should be building a solid foundation with Jesus. And if we do, then we'll be then when things get rough and things get shaky and the world is attacking us, then we can stand strong. Some great verses on this over in Acts 17, 10, 11. And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night into Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. This is one of my favorite verses about learning about being that rock and trusting what you hear. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, and that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were true. The way to get to know Jesus is not to listen to your favorite preacher, but to take those words you hear and verify them in the word and see if they're true and be quick to realize that we're all men, we make mistakes. Even when I'm speaking right now, take a look at these verses up. I do have copies of all my notes on the website if you want. They're probably only good for me since it's just a some quick thoughts. It's more like an outline, but it'll at least give you the verses so you can look them up for yourself. Another verse that I also believe that when it talks about getting to know the Lord, becoming that rock, You can stand any wills of the devil. 2 Timothy 3:16. Easy way to remember. It's Paul's version of John, and when it's talking about the Word of God, you got John 3:16 talking about Jesus and that He's the Word. That's how I remember that this 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture, all. That's from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22, is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Very important there. That again, I'll reemphasize all Scripture. And last I heard, ALL means all, means every single dot, every single line, every single period is all inspired by God. And so I hope you, so just to point to the other John 3:16, that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And I think the important aspect of that verse is whosoever believeth. Whomsoever is, you're a whomsoever, I'm a whomsoever. That's everybody. That's no one's excluded from that. Believeth. Well, believeth, even Satan believes that Jesus exists. He knows that. But this in this terminology, what we're talking about here is more like trusting, that you're putting all of your trust in the Lord and that you're going to follow him and follow what he says. And I hope you read what he says is, and that you study it. That's the whole Bible, not certain passages, not a few favorites that you certain preachers seem to always teach. I grew up some really good churches, and don't get me wrong, but honestly, there were certain aspects of the Bible I had never heard about when I became an adult. That's kind of like why I'm doing what I'm doing now, is because I honestly have not studied the entire Bible from cover to cover like this, where I really analyzed every single verse. And so it may take a long time, but at least I get started. Been working on it for a year now. So I hope that you guys continue to join me on that journey. But that was the whole idea behind it, is it's just more my study, and I'm just sharing it with you. Because actually, for me, to better to understand it, once I study it and read it, and then I write notes about it, and then I talk about it on these videos, I reinforce it in myself. And sometimes the Holy Spirit actually adds things in that I didn't even think about until I stopped recording. It's really fun. So last verse. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that without a foundation built a house upon the earth, and against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. And of course, Jesus here is talking about this other side over here. I don't know if you can see my little cursor. I didn't get the big one. So you can see it's breaking up all in pieces in this painting. Kind of a visual idea of, and what's this based on? It's based on a Christian that starts off good. He built this house. He started to read the Bible. And he put the Bible aside, stopped going to church, thought that, okay, I accepted the Lord. I'm good, and didn't really build a relationship. Well, the minute that the world comes and attacks and tries to sway your understanding, you're not going to have that solid rock of the Christ, of Christ helping you through those times of tribulation. And believe me, we all will go through tribulation. God does it on purpose to strengthen us. And so I know that at least for me, whenever I knew that God was correcting me on something, that I felt good about it afterwards, that he loved me enough that to make sure that I didn't get too far off track, and that and he brought me back in. And I praise him and I thank him so much for that. So that's my lesson for today. And so let's just say a prayer. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, you are my rock. Lord, I love you. I love you so much. I can't wait to the day that I serve with you in heaven, that we can be all as one body, that we all serve together and under your wonderful leadership. And Lord, I can't wait for the opportunity to learn even more about you each day that I study your word. Thank you so much for enlightening us with your words, and that you help us to really put them in our heart and really hold on to them. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Hey, my voice made it. Whole 35 minutes. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. I'm a little worried about that because I wrote a lot of notes today. So I'll talk to you again Monday. And I'm not sure I'll be in church Sunday. I think I still need to make sure I recuperate from this. But I'll see what tomorrow brings. And so if I don't see you Sunday, I'll be online with you. And I hope that you have a very Merry Christmas. And remember that Christ is a solid rock we stand. And that we're celebrating his birth tomorrow. And so that happy Christmas, or Merry Christmas. And we'll talk to you again on Monday. Love you all and have a great day.